We thank Maria Grazia, and we go on to the last lecture of this session, that is before coffee, and that will be by Ashraf Al-Asham, who's also from this research institute, and is taking us back into the nature of trees and the green things. And
thank you. So good evening, everybody. My name is Ashraf Al-Ashab. I'm going to talk to you about the plant microbiome, a little bit far from what we've heard already about human gut and the rest of microbiome. So my talk will give you a little bit insight of the agriculture application of the microbiome utilized here in the Dead Sea and Arava region. First of all, I would like to thank my colleagues, Yael Barlavan and Gideon Winter, who we are on this project. Also, Rivka, Youssef, and Danit. Danit is our master student. Rivka is our lab manager, and Youssef is our lab assistants, who basically run all of these work. Special thanks to ICA Foundation, who supported this project, and the rest of locals. Special thanks to this very big picture, who's including everybody working in this institute, from secretary, other colleagues, and researcher. Special thanks to organizing committee as well. So plant in arid environment. If we look at the aerial satellite picture of Israel, which is the southern part of Israel, we see almost no green in here. So we see you, it's good now? Yeah? So aerial photo shows actually no green in the land. And if we look, if we're going into the ground, we see just very few trees there and around. If you look over the window here, you see almost barren soil and not much growing on. And this is basically because we have very high temperature, up to 46 degrees Celsius. A plant lives here, one of them is acacia. They are suffering from vaporized pressure deficiency, which is about 9 kilopascal. Just to give you a notion of what is this meaning, most plant lives between 0.8 to 0.9 kilopascal, and this is the water deficiency that these plants suffer in this area. They also exposed to very high UV radiation and high salinity. Other plants live in the area beside acacia. We have also atriplex, and we also have eshel. And this plant is very widespread from South Africa up to Egypt, Syria, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, a little bit of southern Iraq, especially in arid environment. They are very tolerant to very high salt condition in soil, very drought areas. Now, what is really interesting is what make these bacteria. Now we know already from previous picture that plant is not a plant, it's also the holobiont, including microorganism. Also our gut is not only us, it's also all the microorganism around us that interfering, and we were really interested in looking into the microbial community in those plants. A little bit of introduction of what kind of microbial community we expected to see in those areas is a thermophilic bacteria, which can tolerate a very high temperature. Other bacteria can tolerate very high salt conditions. Those can survive environment, polyextremophil, and even radiation resistant bacteria, that some people believe that these bacteria might come even from extraterrestrial origin, or being in the very early stages of life formation, because these bacteria really are very resistant to many different stress. Now, what makes these bacteria very resistant to those conditions is because usually they have a special DNA repair mechanisms. They have special protein and special enzymes that help them to survive these very extreme drought conditions. And these bacteria have been utilized widely in chemical industry, medical industry, and also in food industry, and they actually help in shaping the food, medical, and chemistry industry in the 21st century, and still much more to discover about these bacteria. Now, as I listed before, I'm very much interested in the leaf microbiome of these three species I showed you about, and why is that? Because this is an electron microscope of the leaf, and we see a lot of bacteria living there. Actually, it's been estimated 10 to the power of 4 to 10 to the power of 6 is living on the single surface of a leaf. So it's a lot of bacteria. It's taking a lot of interaction. We see a different bacterial community. It's talking to each other, secreting each other. Some of them secrets volatile organic compound. These volatile organic compounds have been found to recruit or even rebel specific wide range of insects. Other bacteria, they fight other bacteria, meaning they fight different pathogens or even fight other fungal pathogens that can infect those plants. Some bacteria excrete auxins or other plant growth hormones that help the survival of the plant. Now, when we looked at the bacterial community on those trees, the question we wanted to ask is how these bacteria is different from the inner side of the bacteria of the plant. So we look at the bacterial community at the surface of the plant compared to the inner surface of the plant, and we see that the bacterial community, each triangle or single hair represents the whole microbiome of a single leaf. So we took many leaves here, and we see that this bacterial community is completely different from inside to outside of the plant. When we're looking at whether different species of the same tree is different, which is resembled by triangle and circle, we see that the external part of the plant is not really very significant. There is no significant difference between different species, but the inner bacterial community is really different. Other basic questions we ask is how this bacterial community is different from January to September following seasonal condition, and we see the bacterial community is not really very significant. It's consistent and not really significant differences all over the year. And that was on the outer canopy. And what I mean by the outer canopy is leaves taken from the two sides external of the trees. And we compared it to inside of the canopy, where the condition is slightly different. It's more shaded, usually have more moisture. And we see the bacterial community is indeed different between January, February, and June, and during the very hot and dry season, it's compared to the external part of the tree. And here we see how the temperature fluctuation throughout of the year. We looked much more into leaves. We took much more samples. Here we have this is the bacterial community of 100 different leaf samples. This is the total bacterial community abundance, and different colors resemble different OTUs of the total bacterial community. We see fluctuation based on different treatment. However, what I really want to stress here is we found about 40 to 60% of the total bacteria were not classified below family level. If we recall earlier lecture, in mice gut, they found like a similar ratio just because people did not really study the mice gut very well, unlike a human where 90% of the bacteria is classified. And here we saw about 40 to 60% of the bacteria is not classified before. And this is not because we can't grow them, just because nobody really checked these extreme environment leaf surface microbiome. And we here thought that there is a huge potential of a big part of bacterial community that have not been discovered before, and we wanted to check their application, or if we can check their application in the area agriculture to help the local agriculture in the area. So we have isolated about 150 species of bacterial isolates. We just took the leaves, we grow them on LB medium, where we grow different colonies, and we pick up different colonies individually, and then we analyze for the whole 16S to see which bacteria belong to there. Now, based on their 16S, we did a phylogenetic tree to see what are those bacteria that we have isolated and how much they are genetically close to each other. Meaning, if they are very, very much has a high genetic similarity, it means more or less it could be the similar species or similar strain. Or in some condition, we have 89.5%, meaning it's even different genus, species, depending on the resolution of the 16S we have. Now, looking into these specific bacteria, we found it's really far from other Bacillus bacteria. And based on those bacteria, we know that those bacteria are very efficient in agriculture, and they have been used as antifungal properties. So most of the bacteria we have, it has some antifungal properties. It also possesses a plant growth hormone, and also can be used as insecticides to help us in current agriculture. We took different bacteria compared to the control, where in the middle, here we have fungus that we grow. In this case, it's Fusarium. And we put our bacteria in four dots like this, and we check if these bacteria can inhibit the growth of the fungus. And this is a picture taken in 3 days, and this is after 5 days. And after 5 days here at the control, we see that the Fusarium took over the plate. And here we see that our bacteria really inhibit the growth of Fusarium. And we also investigated these bacteria on different fungus, in this case, Botrytis. Now, Fusarium is a root bacteria that infects roots and seeds. Botrytis infects fruits and infects the plant itself, leaves as well. So it was really interesting even to show these bacteria is active again against Botrytis. Now, we know that the genetic similarity between these bacteria and the other bacillus is far enough to be considered as a new species. We even were able to grow it at 10 degrees Celsius and even at 56 degrees Celsius, mimicking the extreme condition that we have in the desert. And this has made it an identical candidate for agriculture. Step forward to move it to plants. Here we have Botrytis infected leaves. Here we sprayed our bacteria 12 hours before the Botrytis infection. Here we sprayed the bacteria after Botrytis infection, and we see that the activity of our strain were really excellent even before and even after the Botrytis infection. We moved to whole plant in a bot experiment, and we see these are the control where the Botrytis got infected and they really make the plant die. And we sprayed our strain 12 hours before infection. And this is not sprayed plant, just to compare, and it's behave just like a control. To give it a little bit more weight, we checked it compared to Switch, a commercial formulation, which is known among Khaklaim and among farmers. And we applied both the Switch and our isolate after the fungal infection, and we see even our isolates has a slightly better activity than existed formulation. Our current work now, also these bacteria, also other bacteria, we have found other bacteria, that, but these also were effective in antifungal activities for both Fusarium and Botrytis. We also grow it in petri dish. We found it produce about 70 milligrams of auxins, which is the plant growth hormones. Now, also we checked the other bacteria that known to produce auxins and have been used in the agriculture and produce about similar ranges. However, our bacteria have been isolated from the current environment, meaning it can resist the current atmosphere, meaning it really can be useful for agriculture application. So we're looking at the commercial potential of our unique bacteria that extracted also plant growth hormones. Other bacteria we found, I'm not presenting here, have Berbervillus lactobacillus-like strains. Now, these bacteria is known to be very effective against wide range of insects, and we're currently looking for its interaction and how it's going to affect the gut microbiome of different insects, Plasma tobacco, Francisca, and Rhinocorius beetle, a major insect that affecting our area and also worldwide. With that, I would like to thank you.
So first of all, First of all, thank you for the very nice presentation. But do you have any speculation why, evolutionary-wise, did these trees or these bacteria develop with their antifungal or anti-insectual potency, where I don't see or I don't understand the presence of these organisms in the desert?
So, plant living in these extreme conditions must have been adapted to this area, meaning extreme condition. Now, we learned before, even us, it's not only us, it's also the bacteria within us that make how we behave. It's also similar to plants. So, if these plants need to be survived, it's not because of the plant genes, it's also because of the whole ambient of the plant, this means including the microbiome in it. So there is a strong correlation. If you wish to say it's a co-evolution of the plant and the microbiome that yield to this survival.
Also, I'll ask many of the antifungal compounds are quite toxic.
So we did not look for toxicity. That's a very good question. We don't look for toxicity yet, but since it's close also to Bacillus subtile, which is already have been used and very extensive research have been done, so we predict it's not toxic yet. But we are currently what we are trying to do is we are trying to isolate these bacteria, to isolate what they extract and the compound, and also to check for toxicity.
So I wonder if you look at the rhizosphere at all, because the root of a plant is like the intestine, except inside out. Yeah.
Yes, what I did not mention in my presentation is I also look at soil and also look at the rhizosphere. So there is a strong correlation between what it grows on the leaf, what it grows on the soil, and what is in the leaves. So the bulk of the microbial community is in soil, and it's very much rich in the rhizosphere, but there is also a strong correlation between what is in the rhizosphere and in the leaves. So if I want to give you a number, is about 30 to 50% of the total bacterial community is shared among these different niches.
Excellent speakers of this session, and to thank you for your attention and for the good discussion. Thank you.